16th on the baritone saxophone music of Walter Hartley, and it's a biography and performer's guide to the concertos for the baritone saxophone. The research of music is actually really diverse and unique because it's much more a derivative of the performers or the researchers' own personal analysis and actual research that's conventionally known, which that's really, it makes it a complex idea for a program such as this because it's not, you're not going in looking at a specific history or a molecule. You're actually looking at a piece of music and deciding how someone else should play it in the future and why it should even exist right now. Why is it relevant? Much as if you look in the canon of literature from the past, why is To Kill a Mockingbird studied today? That's what we have to do in from a music performance standpoint for music research. So that's the focal point of what my research project was based on. And the development of this project was crafted because many of the works for baritone saxophone aren't known. The saxophone was developed late in history from an instrument perspective. In 1842, Adolf Sax presented his first saxophone, which was the bass saxophone, in Brussels, Germany, and people actually destroyed it. So he went back, made a new one, and came back in 1846, and that's when he got the patent. By this time, orchestras were already set. They had instrumentation, ensembles were already all across Europe, so it kind of missed its introduction point into the musical field, especially within classical music. So for the problem, the concertos for the baritone saxophone aren't recognized and they are never performed. The baritone saxophone concertos merit a greater recognition than this because they're actually very good pieces, just nobody knows about them because they don't fall within that canon. The performance knowledge and study of this repertoire is just non-existent. Nobody's done any. Not one research study is published for any of the works I've found. And this is important because new repertoire is pertinent to the development of the classical saxophone, especially with its such late introduction, because even today, music scholars and non-music scholars, when you hear saxophone, you don't think of classical music. There's such a big jazz focus, or even in pop, like in ska music, but nobody thinks of saxophone as a classical instrument. And which is interesting, because when you look at literature, or just the trend in history, the saxophone was developed for a spot in the symphony orchestra. But that never took. There are only works with saxophone in general in French repertoire. And even in modern pieces, the saxophone hasn't been added to the new symphony. This changed, however, with the introduction of military bands. The saxophone was very popular because it was loud. People could hear it from miles away when you had bands marching, especially in France and in German marching bands. 150 years of music for the saxophone by Jean-Marie Landex illustrates 12,000 works for saxophone, which that's really significant. However, those 12,000 works are predominantly for the alto saxophone, which has been studied, people know it, which for the baritone saxophone, it's still one of the standard instruments. It's in every modern ensemble. So it was curious to me why there's no study of it, why people don't encourage it more, why the repertoire that's being composed isn't added when they still want you to perform it, they just don't want you to study it. So it's even recommended repertoire lists from every university in America and in Europe. They have maybe two pieces for baritone saxophone that you should look at, and about 30 to 60 pieces for alto or tenor saxophone. Which, it's really interesting because the baritone saxophone was created before those two. So it has an older history, but has less repertoire. So that's a big problem, and it's a disconnect from what you are told in study of performance, but then they don't have anything to study, and there's no previous literature. From my research, I found that there are 14 concertos known, but zero pieces are within the standard repertoire of what you learn in school. That's from undergraduate through a PhD. No standard rep. None are on the list of you have to perform this piece or you won't get your degree. The style of these works are a mix between jazz or classical, or there's a third string, which is both. The purpose of this project is to examine and analyze the concertos for the saxophone written by Walter Hartley from historical, theoretical, pedagogical, and performance perspective. The questions that I developed based on my literature review were, what is the history and the inspiration for these works? How did it come to be commissioned, and what processes were involved with its production? How does this work compare to Hartley's other compositions for solo instruments? How is this work organized, and what is its significant features regarding structure, style, harmonic language, and rhythmic character? What strategies exist to achieve the proper performance practice of this work and overcome the technical issues presented by this composition? And lastly, what is the historical significance of the work? Is its significant contribution to the saxophone concerto repertoire? The methodology for this project is very unique to music, and I haven't seen it in any other style of research. But the first step was the selection of the work itself out of the 14. And that's based on the reputation of the composer, and that involves how many other pieces have they worked? How many times are these works performed? Where did they go to school? What performance venues has the work been performed in? All those things boost the contribution of that work. Do people know about it? Do people not? And the second aspect was the musical value of the work itself. Will it help you become a better performer? Will it encourage you to develop new techniques? Those things you have to consider when you look at what work to study, because if it's not going to offer you any musical value in the end, then there's no point to play. Procedures for studying the history of the selected composition was first the commissioning project. Who was the soloist that the work was written for? Saying, where have they performed? Where did they go to school? Have they won awards? Have they performed in multiple countries? And then the collaboration between the composers and the soloists. The musical analysis looks at the overall forms of the work, the identification of important themes and motives, and the organization themes and tonal centers, because you need this information for when you're playing. You need to know where to shape the phrasing. What is the audience going to do when you play this way, as opposed to playing a certain passage another way? It's very almost like psychology based. Like, if you play these sounds this way, what reaction is it going to cause? The performance practice of these works, when you study, you need to look at range, if there's wide intervals, quick articulations, dynamic extremes, and extended technique. These are things that build you as a performer, and these are the ideas that make a work worthy of being studied. So, the concerto by Walter Hartley is the chamber concerto for baritone saxophone and wind octet. Walter Hartley was born in 1927 in Washington, D.C. He's an American composer, and he studied wasn't starting with the standard classical music. He got his degrees, his bachelor's, his master's, and his PhD from the Eastman School of Music of the University of Rochester. And currently, he is the Professor Emeritus of Music at Fredona State University in Fredona, New York. He has worked for saxophone from 1951 through 2005. The concerto itself was composed in 1988. It is a three-movement work lasting 9 minutes and 30 seconds and is published by Dorn Publications. And in general, this is a very academic work. It's not so much as if you don't understand musical concepts, you'll find it interesting, but you won't per se call it pretty music. It's very mathematical almost. The work utilizes the full range of the instrument, from low A to altissimo C, which is a span of almost 4 octaves, which on any instrument, that's significant, but on saxophone, when standard range is 2.5 octaves, when you go a full octave more than that, that's really saying something as a performer, and that boosts the level of the work. The harmonic structure is atonal. It's classical music, but it's more modern, so you won't find any scales like C major, you won't hear any major chords. Nothing you hear in this work is pretty. It's very not standard to what you would hear in classical music. Now, orchestration, the solos is heard easily, which is great for the baritone saxophone because it's not a very loud instrument when you play it in classical music. It has a very dark tone. And to serve that, the orchestration being light really emphasizes its beauty as an instrument. So in movement one, Hartley uses serial principles. And in this, it's a four-note pattern, which are called cells. And this is a modified structure from 12-tone music where in a 12-tone work, you have to use each of 12 pitches before you can repeat any new system of 12 notes. But in this, he breaks that and he uses 4-note intervals that have transpositional equivalence and inversional equivalence. And I'll explain what that means in just a second. So in this excerpt from the opening, each one of these 5 sets of 4 are essentially the same exact musical expression. Each cell would technically be considered the same thing in this work. Even though they're on different notes and they will sound differently, it's the same exact musical expression. So when you play through the work, you have to take that into account. So when you're going up, you're playing the same 4-note cell, and that creates a new line instead of looking at this because there's no tonal center. You have to consider what cell you're in rather than what key you're in. And below in the blue, those are inversional techniques. So that means you can have 2 different sets and they can be played backwards and still represent the same character. Movement 2 is a ternary form. It's very standard for classical music. It's just ABA, so you have one section, a contracting section, and then you go back to the beginning. That's very standard form from back to ancient Greek music. But the orchestration, it's interesting because the octet plays all open fifths, which that's also a very standard classical progression. However, the soloist who's playing the lyrical melody is playing half steps and quarter steps away from those notes, so it still you don't have any tonal center. So you'll hear a very classical background with a very dissonant melody over it, and it creates an interesting effect. So in this is an excerpt from the first page of the second movement. There is no tonal center. center, and while the soloist plays through this, the orchestra is just playing whole notes in open fists. So the entire work is based upon the soloist, and that also creates an interesting idea for a concerto, because concertos don't often work that way. In a concerto, the orchestra often plays side by side with the soloist, and they emphasize each other. In this, it's all about the soloist, so you have to take that into account as a performer, because it's all about what you do over the open fifth progression. In movement three, the structure is a modified ternary form, which is ABA again, but the A section is movement one. The B section is movement two, and when it goes back to A, it combines movement one and two, so you get musical ideas with the four note cells throughout one, the first A section and the second A section, and then you get the open structure in the B section, and it brings the whole work back together. For performance practice, there are no common scales used, so you have to take into account the cells. Because in the study of music, you base your technique off of method books. So that's scales and etudes and arpeggios. This piece doesn't utilize those, so you have a completely new technical structure to learn. So you have to take each of the four note cells separately and take that and do that full range across the instrument in every octave, and that's how you build that technique for future use. Luckily, Walter Hartley uses very specific phrase markings, and he gives you plenty of areas to breathe, so that's already laid out for you. However, he uses altissimo outside of the standard register. That's even hard for university level performers or professional performers who already have gone through training. So it's important to work on these separately outside of the piece, especially for the baritone saxophone, for no works really utilize these techniques. Conclusions. The concerto was developed in time of serialism, which is 12-tone music, but he takes that further and develops his own sort of character with his four note cells, breaking that pattern so he can repeat different characters every four notes instead of every 12 notes. While Hartley's other compositions also utilize 12-tone idea, his chamber concerto is unique and composed in a way that showcases the academic side while also showcasing what the performer can do on that instrument. The work is a three-movement concerto with three separate structures for each movement, so that really boosts its technical ability for what it can give to the performer studying. While other concertos for the baritone saxophone exist, not all of them work. A lot of them are over-orchestrated, and many don't have piano reductions, and not often will a student performer be able to perform with an orchestra. So that you have to take that into account as well when you're deciding what pieces to study and why you should study a work. So the Chamber Concerto for Baritone Saxophone and Wind Octave by Walter Hartley should be studied from a performance standpoint, because it utilizes everything that standard repertoire concertos use. So that makes it the perfect piece to add to standard rep, and that's why I chose it to study.